Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
All right, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to give this talk here. And this is the title of my talk. And this work is joint work with my colleague, Defeng Sun at the National University of Singapore and Dr. Yang from Nanjing University. So I will first briefly describe the covariance selection problems and then go on to describe the problem with group lasso regularization. And a big part of the talk is on describing a Newton CG-based proximal point algorithm to solve the problems, and then present some numerical results on the performance of the Newton CG-based PPA. So what is a covariance selection problem? So here we have a random vector X following a multivariate normal distribution with covariant matrix sigma, and Y1 up to YP's are samples drawn in them independently from this distribution. And our job is to estimate the covariant matrix sigma, whose inverse is expected to be sparse. All right, and the significance of the sparsity in the inverse covariant matrix is motivated by the results by Dempster in 1972, who proved that Xi and Xj's are conditionally independent given all other variables, if and only if the ij elements of the inverse covariant matrix is equal to zero. So, and the problem of estimating the sparsity pattern of sigma inverse is called covariance selection. So for this talk, I'll let S to be the sample covariant matrix. And when the maximum likelihood estimators of sigma will be the minimizer of this negative log likelihood function, right, with the sample covariant matrix as the input. And X is an estimation on the inverse covariant matrix. Right? And we know that if the sample covariant matrix is positive definite, then the estimator will be just S itself. The MLE estimator will be just S itself. Right? But of course, in general, if S is not positive definite, then these problems may not have S may not be the solution to these problems. And furthermore, we know that when the sample size is low, usually S is not a good estimator of sigma.
Why couldn't you just take S inverse? Because it may not be
positive definite, and also sometimes it may not be a robust estimation of sigma for many statistical purposes.
If you have enough samples, it should be.
It should be, yeah. And usually you have to have quite a big sample size. So because S may not be a good estimator of sigma, so sometimes people impose certain conditions on X to get a more robust estimation. And one of the main typical requirement is to impose a sparsity requirements on X. And this has been done by this group of people. So you minimize the negative log likelihood function plus a L1 regularization on X. So that this regularization term is to encourage sparsities in X. Right? And we know that this problem is convex and is easily solvable in theory, but it is still challenging in practice when the matrix dimension is big, say more than 1,000. And there are many customized algorithms to solve these L1 regularized problems. And here is a list, an incomplete list of the method that has been designed. Earliest one is based on coordinate descent. And then subsequently, people propose projected subgradient methods and also use Nesterov optimum first order method to solve these problems. You can also use alternating direction methods. And we have also designed a Newton CG-based proximal point algorithm to solve these problems. But this is for more general problems of log determinant minimization problems with linear equality constraints. You can also use interior point methods customized to these problems. And more recently, we have a very fast method which is called QUIC, and it's really quick for solving these unconstrained problems. So, to summarize, for these very specialized problems, the state of the art now is this method called QUIC. Okay. And this is done by... Okay, we are minimizing the negative log likelihood function plus L1 regularization terms on the variable X. With respect to X, that's right. Of the Gaussian distribution. Yeah. So this work is done by Indrajit and Pradeep and his group in UT Austin. Sometimes in applications, the variables may not be. We may not just want sparsities in the X. We may want to impose certain group structures on X. All right, so maybe sometimes physically the random variables, they have some physical meanings and they should be grouped together. So they may have some group structures. And in this case, you may want to exploit that knowledge. So instead of using an L1 regularization, you may use a group lasso kind of regularization, where the indices, where this XG here means the elements of X in certain group, and G is the set of indices in this group, right? And here the norm you can use two norms, which has been done by Yuan and Ling for linear regression, and in another paper by Duchi, the infinity norm has been considered in covariance selection. You can also use one norm if you want, and if you use one norm, you'll just get back your original L1 regularizations. And here in this talk, I'm going to assume that I know the group structures of the random variables. Okay, if the group structure is not known, and then I think certain people have already proposed certain methods to try to learn the group structures of the inverse covariance matrix. So let me give you an illustration on why group structure may be a good idea. A group basso may be a good idea. So here I have a covariance matrix with this sparsity pattern. And this is what I can recover if I use the L1 regularizations. So for a weight value of 0.5, this is for a weight value of 1, 5. So you can see that the estimated solutions is not as good as, doesn't match the true solutions very well. But if I use a group lasso type of regularization with L2 norm, and you can see that the sparsity patterns is actually matches the true solutions pretty well.
What was the previous one? Sorry, the previous?
Previous one is L1 norm.
Oh, just L1. Okay. You have group lasso.
Yeah. I hope you are convinced that sometimes using group lasso is a good idea. Now I'm going to consider this problem now, minimizing the negative log likelihood function plus group lasso regularization terms, and possibly with linear constraints on X, on the elements of X. For example, sometimes you know that you have a prior knowledge on some conditional independence of certain elements of X. You can impose that into these equality constraints by setting xij equal to 0. Right. So GL is the group structures, and I'm assuming that the groups are disjoint. And the norms here, typically I will consider either the 1 norm, 2 norm, or the infinity norm. And WL is just the local weights for each group. And if you have certain explicit sparsity constraints, in X, you can enforce that through the linear constraints, AX equal to B. Yes?
So you're given the groups?
Yes.
Where do those come from?
Sometimes you may physically, you have some knowledge about this random variable should be belonging to this systems and another set of random variables belonging to another set of systems and things like that. But as I've said, there are also papers who describe how to learn the group structures. But it is very few papers on these topics. So far, I only managed to see one by Marlin and Murphy.
By who?
Marlin and Murphy. But I think typically the group structure will come more naturally from physical meanings rather than from by using a machine learning algorithm to learn the structures. Right? So this is the problem I'm going to consider, and I will describe approximate point algorithms to solve these problems. So I think many of you are not familiar with approximate point algorithm, so I'm going to give a brief description of that. So suppose we are minimizing a function f, convex function f. So at a given iterate xk, the PPA algorithm will generate the next iterate by minimizing f plus this quadratic proximity terms. All right? And beta here is just a parameter, given parameter. All right? And these subproblems is usually known as the Morey-Yoshida regularization subproblems. So in each iteration of the PPA, you need to solve a Morey-Yoshida regularization subproblems. So you need to solve a minimization problems in each iteration. So let me give you a little bit of background on Morey-Yoshida regularizations. So let psi be a proper closed convex function, and beta is a given parameter. The Morey-Yoshida regularization of psi will be the minimum value of this function plus this quadratic regularization term, right? So for each x, you solve a minimization problems, you get these values, big psi of x. And the minimize this problem is called the proximal point mapping of psi, and this is just the minimizer. So I would use pi to denote the minimizer. And it can be shown that the Morey-Yoshida regularization function psi is continuously differentiable and convex, and this gradient is given by this simple expression here. And the proximal point mapping is non-expansive, meaning that the norm of pi x minus pi y is less than or equal to the norm of x minus y. Right? And the more important point is that if you want to minimize psi, it's equivalent to minimizing the my function. So my stands for Morey-Yoshida. So the good thing about this my function is that psi can be non-smooth, non-differentiable. But this one, you are minimizing a continuously differentiable functions. So that is the advantage of using this Morey-Yoshida regularization my functions. Okay? Now I'm going to apply the PPAs to our problem. So in that case, I have to look at the Morey-Yoshida regularization functions of our component functions. In this, for example, the minus log determinant functions. So to do that, I will need to define the following two functions, phi plus, which is given by these functions, square root of t squared plus 4 beta plus t, and phi minus to be this one. Now if I have a symmetric matrix Y, whose eigenvalue decomposition is PD, P transpose, then I can define the matrix counterpart of phi plus and phi minus. So you just keep the same eigenvectors, but you modify the eigenvalues to be from D to be phi plus D and so on. Alright? Now with these two matrices, I can derive my proximal point mapping of psi, which is the minus log determinant of x. So the proximal point of mapping of psi would be phi plus of x. So in this case, you can see that this proximal point mapping can be computed in O of n cubed flops because we need one eigenvalue decomposition to compute this phi plus. and my function psi will be given is given analytically by these functions. Okay. Where I also need to look at the proximal point mappings of the p norms of x. So p norm is just the usual p norms. In this case, the proximal point mapping of psi will be just x minus the projection of x onto the q norm ball with radius beta. Okay, and q is the number that satisfies this equation here, 1 over p plus 1 over q equal to 1. Okay, so and this guy is just the standard Euclidean projections onto this ball. So p for p equal to 1, 2 or infinity, the computation of this projection is simple. Basically, you just need to do for p equals to infinity, you need to do a sorting of the arguments, and for the other two it's really simple, right? So now I have with these two ingredients, I can go on to design a PPA for our problems. Now this is the problem that we are interested in: minimizing the negative log likelihood function plus this group Lasso regularization subject to equality constraints Ax equals to b. Now I'm going to define this operation Px to be extracting all the elements of x in different groups, in various groups. And I'm going to assign all these variables to be y1, y2, and so on, and let it to be this vector y. Okay? With this new variable y, my objective function would be simply becomes psi of y, which is equal to the sum of wl times the p norm of yl. Right? And then the problem is transformed into minimizing the negative log likelihood function plus psi, subject to equality constraints ax equal to b, px minus y equal to 0, and x positive definite. All right? Yes? Is the elements in this group. Say for example the first column.
It's a square matrix.
No, you know, it's not necessary. You treat it as a vector. Because you just extract the elements in the groups that you are interested in.
Oh, I see.
You can, for example, you can extract the first columns of X as one group. And the second columns as another second group and so on. No. In this case, we do not allow overlapping. If you have overlapping, you need to separate them by introducing extra variables. Does that answer your question? So this is the problem that we are going to design our PPA algorithm for. So to do that, we are still not there yet. To do that, I have to introduce some more terminologies and some pre-processing steps. So let L be the associated Lagrangian function of the previous problem. So the Lagrangian function is just the objective functions minus the multipliers times Ax minus multipliers lambda inner product with Ax minus B minus the multipliers eta inner product with Px minus Y. It is equal to this expression if x is positive definite and is defined to be plus infinity otherwise. So our problem is transformed into minimizing f of x y, and f of x y is the essential objective function of our transform problems, which is in turn given by maximizing the Lagrangian function with respect to the multipliers. Okay. Now with that, now look at the Morey-Yoshida regularization of F. So this is the definition for the Morey-Yoshida regularization. You're minimizing F plus these quadratic proximity terms. But you know that F is given by maximizing L, the Lagrangian function, with respect to the multipliers. So I have a min-max problem Now I can switch the min max to be max min. Okay, under certain condition you can switch this, and this can be proven rigorously. So I'm going to switch the min max to max min. Now I'm going for the minimization steps. I'm minimizing L with respect to X and Y. Now I can use the MR regularization of the minus log determinant function and psi that I have developed previously and substitute it into this expression here. And I will get this MY function to be maximizing this function theta. Okay? So theta corresponds to this inner minimization. Theta corresponds to this inner minimization. And theta is this function here, looks very complicated, but is nothing but this minimization, and this the analytical expression of these minimization problems. Okay. So the Morey-Yoshida regularization function is to evaluate this MY function at XY, you have to solve the maximization problems, maximize theta with respect to the multipliers, the dual variables. So W here is nothing but a linear function of X and so on, and Z is a linear function of Y and eta. So the good thing about this function theta is that it is continuously differentiable. Okay. So now we are ready to describe the PPA algorithms. So this is what we do, right? The standard template. Given the kth iterate, you generate the k plus 1 iterate by minimizing f plus these quadratic proximity terms. Now, to get the kth plus 1 iterate, I'm going to solve this problem, maximization problems, with respect to the dual variables. Okay, once I get the dual variables, I will be able to get my k plus 1 iterates xk plus 1, yk plus 1 by doing a gradient descent steps on the MY functions, f. Okay. So, given xk and yk, I generate the next iterate by solving a maximization problems with respect to the dual variables. Once I get the dual variables, I'm able to get the primal variables, x and y, by doing a gradient descent steps with respect to the MY functions. So the most expensive steps in this iteration will be to solve these maximization problems. And I'm going to use a Newton CG method to solve the subproblems. So we know that the optimality conditions for the subproblem is that the gradient of theta is equal to zero. Theta is this the objective function in the subproblems. Theta is the objective function in the subproblems, and this is an unconstrained minimization problem. So the optimality condition is that the gradient of theta is equal to zero. Okay, but theta is continuously differentiable, but it's not twice continuously differentiable. So you cannot use the standard Newton's method to solve these problems. Okay. But however, it has some property called strongly semi-smooth. So you can use a semi-smooth Newton method to solve these problems. Okay. And here I call it generalized Newton method. And sometimes it's also called semi-smooth Newton method. So this is the standard template for Newton's method to solve an equation, a system of nonlinear equations. So I'll just skip that. Now the only thing that you have to pay attention to is that the Hessian here is not ordinary Hessian, it's an element of the sub-differential of the gradient. Right? So you can potentially have many candidates for this generalized Hessian. Now, under certain conditions, we can prove, under certain constraint non-degeneracy conditions on the primer problem, we can prove that each of the element here is negative definite. So, in that case, you would get a quadratic convergence for your semi-smooth Newton method. So to solve these linear systems, it would be too expensive to use the linear solvers, and we are going to use a preconditioned conjugate gradient to solve the linear systems. Right. So let me repeat again. In outer iteration, it's very simple. To generate the next iterate, we have to solve a subproblem involving theta, and we are solving these subproblems by a Newton. Semi-smooth Newton method. Okay? And for each Newton systems, we are using a PCG method to solve the linear systems. Now we can also accelerate the PPA outer iterations by using a Newton's method also. So this is the standard updates for the outer iterations. You just do a standard gradient descent steps. You can also do a Newton steps. But this is too complicated, so I'm not going to describe it here, but you can do a Newton step as well. Okay, when you are sufficiently close to the optimum solution, right? Now, nowadays, there are many people who are interested in alternating direction method, all kinds of alternating direction methods. So here, we can also do the alternating direction methods for these problems. And in this case, it turns out that it is much more convenient for you to apply the EDM methods to the dual problems. And the dual problems is given as follows: to maximize B transpose lambda plus log determinant of Z subject to these constraints. Okay, that the Q norm of eta should be less than or equals to omega. Omega. Okay. And also you have the constraint that A transpose lambda plus B transpose eta plus z is equal to s, and z has to be positive definite. So for these dual problems, the omega Lagrangian function will be given as follows. Right. So basically, this term here is to penalize any violation of the equality constraints in the dual problems. If all your variables already are, this is already after some manipulations, but basically this term is to penalize any violations of the dual constraints, right? Now with this formulation of the omega Lagrangian function, you can write down the alternating direction method as follows. So for the first steps, you fix all the variables except lambda, and you find the minimizers, lambda k plus 1. After you generate it, you fix eta, sorry, you fix all the variables except eta, and you generate eta k plus 1, and so on. Now, unfortunately, there is no convergence theory for these alternating direction methods when you have more than three blocks of variables. So for the standard theory, only applies to two blocks of variables up here. Okay. But anyway, you can try and see whether you can get any convergence for this ADM method, even though you theoretically do not have any convergence results. So I'm going to test the algorithms by looking at some problems. So here I'm going to let A to be sigma inverse. I'm going to generate sigma inverse as follows. So the first case is that A is a random sparse positive definite matrix with a blocky kind of group structure. Something like what we have seen in the figures. And also I'm going to test on artificial problems tested in some statistics papers by Yuan and Ling and Fang. And I picked two more difficult cases from this list, which is called AR1. And this one is actually just a tri-diagonal matrix. A and circle. Circle is also a tri-diagonal matrix, but you have one element at the top right corners, another element on the top left, bottom left corner. And for once I have this true covariant matrix, I will generate two NIID samples from the multivariate Gaussian distributions. Okay, and then use that to be our sample covariate matrix. So for the group structures, I'm going to impose just column-wise group structures. Okay, and if we also have, I'm also going to set some of the elements to zero when I know that the inverse covariate matrix at that position is equal to zero. So out of the all the zero elements of the inverse covariate matrix, I'm going to set about 50% of them to be zero in my linear equality constraints. Okay. So how do I terminate our algorithms? We will terminate our algorithms based on duality gaps and the primal and the dual feasibilities conditions. So the relative gap will be the difference between the primal and the dual objective functions divided by the sum of their values. And the residual will be the maximum of the primal infeasibilities, dual infeasibilities, and the relative gap. Right? And we'll stop the algorithms when the residual is less than 10 to the minus 5. And similarly, we do stop the ADMs if it is the residual is less than 10 to minus 5, or the maximum number of iterations is less than 2,000, is equal to 2,000. Sorry, I made a typo here, it should be 2,000. So now let's see this the progress of the residuals with respect to the number of when the iteration progress. So this is for PPA. This is for PPA. And you can see that it converges in about less than 30 or 35 outer iterations. All right, this is for four different problems. But for ADM, even after, oh, here I use 1,000, okay. Even after 1,000 iterations, you can see that for some problems, there's no progress at all in the residuals. Okay, so you just stuck somewhere and you cannot make further progress. But for some other easier problems, you can see that ADM can also make good progress in reducing the residual. Okay. And this is for P equal to 2. And for P equal to infinity, you have a similar picture. For PPA, you can reduce the residuals less than 10 to the minus 6 in about less than 35 outer iterations. For ADM, even after 1,000 iterations, for some of the problems, you cannot get further progress. It just basically stagnate after certain iterations. And here is a table describing the breakdowns of different iterations and timings. So for the random problems, you can see that PPA takes 32 outer iterations to reach the required tolerance, and it solves 83 Newton systems, and for each Newton systems it takes about 75 PCG steps to solve the systems, and the timing is 1,400 seconds. But if you look at ADM, it's very fast. It converges to the required accuracies in 321 iterations, and the time is 5 times faster. So that's for random problems. So ADM, when it works well, when it works, it sometimes works very well. But you can see that for some other problems, AR1 and circle, even after 2,000 iterations, it cannot make further progress. It makes very little progress in the residuals. Okay. Now for PPA, for the easier problems like AR2, the timing is very fast. It takes about 163 seconds to get to the required accuracies, whereas ADM, it takes about 1,400 seconds, and it still does not reach the required accuracies. And these are all for problems with dimension 1,000. Okay, similarly for P equal to infinity, you have a similar picture. Okay. Now, I would like to emphasize that our framework is actually quite more general, so you can use this framework to solve more general problems. For example, in this latest paper by Chandrasekaran and Pablo on later variable Gaussian graphical on graphical model selections. In there, they have to solve a problem of this form. But after some reformulation, we can reformulate it into this kind of problems, log determinant problems with some linear terms plus linear equality constraints. And we can immediately apply our algorithm to solve these problems. And in fact, they have done so using our algorithm. So to summarize, we have proposed a Newton CG-based proximal point method to solve log determinant optimization problems with group lasso regularization with linear equality constraints. And it is applicable to group lasso with L1, L2, or L infinity norm regularization. And from the numerical results, we have shown that it works more robustly than ADM methods and is able to obtain relatively high accuracy solutions. Okay, and it is more flexible than many specialized algorithms designed for L1 regularized covariate selection problems. Right. And I haven't touched on the convergence theory for this algorithm, but we can show that the algorithm converges linearly for the outer iterations, and the semi-smooth Newton CG methods converges at least superlinearly for the subproblems when we have constrained non-degeneracy conditions. Okay. And actually this PPA framework is actually quite flexible. You can also use it to design algorithms to solve problems of interest recently, like say for example in robust PCA. And for example, in the talks by Xu Huan, he mentioned about a problem of this form. You can also use this framework to solve a problem like this. Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Time for more than a few questions.
Yes. Sorry?
Four blocks of variables.
Right, exactly. Yes.
If you change the order in which you update, what happens? Why did you choose the particular variable?
It doesn't really matter so much. The order of the update doesn't really matter so much because it's basically a Gauss-Seidel kind of update. Sorry, the XOR kind of update. It doesn't really matter so much. Yeah. We have tried that. Yeah. Yeah, we have tried that. Yeah. Yes.
When you're solving your subproblems, how important is it to get exact solutions?
Not important, not so important. That's why instead of quadratic convergence, sometimes I can only get superlinear convergence. And if the Newton direction is not solved to very high accuracies. Yeah. But you need to at least be more accurate than the outer, the progress that you have already achieved in the outer iterations. Otherwise, you will destroy the progress in the outer iterations.
So is there some automatic way in which you can say, can you tune your accuracy?
Yes. Yeah, it will basically based on the convergence criteria for the outer iterations. So the inner subproblems, you have to solve it at least maybe two or five times more accurately than the convergence criteria that you have achieved in the outer iterations. Yeah, that's right.
So related to that, does the convergence rate depend on the conditions on beta in your proximal
yes,
point?
Yes, yes. Beta, it is proportional to the condition number of the Newton systems is proportional to beta.
So it doesn't need to go to zero?
No, it doesn't need to go to zero. That's the good thing about PPA. But of course, if you want to, there's a trade-off between how fast the outer iteration converges versus how easy you want to solve the subproblems. Yeah, there's a trade-off. Sometimes if beta is very small, the outer iteration converges very fast, but the inner iterations becomes very hard to solve. So usually there's a trade-off between this, the speed you achieve in the outer iterations versus the difficulties in solving the inner subproblems. Yes.
Any other questions?
All right, thank you.